Did you?
You have to come into the covenant of God with me. I want everybody here today to give it a little more value, because it's the words to this song that God wants us to draw into today.
What God said to me today, and I'm going to have to be honest with you guys,
He taught me to keep it real. I asked God, I say, Lord, how do I look to you? You see, a lot of us are really humiliating ourselves to God. So when I asked him a question, I said, Lord, how do I look? How do I look to you? You want me to go forth and bring this message? Lord, how do I look to you? And the Lord said, you look like the donkey that carried the prophet on his back. I said, the donkey that carried the prophet on his back. Now, all of us know that the donkey is one of the dumbest animals in the world. And y'all agree with me? We all know a donkey to be the dumbest animal. I'm here for that. And we also know that the Bible refers to a donkey having ass. So when the Lord said, I look like to him, a donkey carried a prophet in the back. About Balaam and Balak. Balaam was a prophet of God. And he got caught up between the king and instruction from God. And he found himself on the back of a donkey. So I said, well, so today you said, well, stand before the people. Because being that the donkey is dumb and he's known as an ass, so you want me to stand before the people and the people as a dumb ass. Yes, because I'm willing to humiliate myself to God. So and no matter how you reflect this thing, we go through a lot of things in our life because of our disconnection with God and because of our lack of knowledge and our lack of relationship with God. I need somebody to go start with what's in your character. Read 133rd Psalm. Somebody start with chapter 1. Read out loud, we are like, because God's going to be talking today.
Behold, how good and how pleasant is it for brethren to dwell together in unity.
The word of God says how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. I'm going to say this before we go any further. Everybody here is welcome to participate. You got any questions? Yes. Can somebody can expand with me what that means? What is that saying? What is the scriptures telling me? How pleasant and good it is
for his children to come together and honor him, praise him, you know, worship, to be in unity, to be on one accord, you know.
Somebody open their word, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. You're almost there. Because when we operating out of our gifts in the house of God, we have to understand that Jesus gave gifts to men. Every last one of us have a different gift. And out of our gifts, we have to function together in those gifts. And the way to function in those gifts, we have to function in unity, collectively together. Come on, Pastor.
Yeah. No, basically like you were saying, it says to dwell in unity, so it's like...
I can't hear you.
It says to dwell in unity, so like, you know, like, a lot of times, you know, people, we find ourselves being jealous of the other or envying the next person instead of focusing on ourselves. And that blocks us from being able to dwell in unity with our brethren or our sister, you feel me?
Amen.
And it's like, I guess you could say pride, yeah.
That's it. That is the key word right there, pride. Because we allow pride to puff up. And that spirit of jealousy will come in. And it's a hindrance. Because right now I can sing. I sure wish I could sing. But I'm really just a teacher. But I want a vocals. I want vocals like he got. With a way to really move my soul with his voice. I'm jealous of him. Because he done moved the people in the church with his beautiful singing. Now, I can't receive the word of God because I'm caught up in his gift. But see, he's a minister, a musician. His job is to move our souls. He is to usher in the spirit of God. That's his job. And once that job is complete, now here's the next position. Go to chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians. Because what God wants y'all to see is how we look to him.
not concerning spiritual gifts. Brethren, I will not have you ignorant.
Ain't gonna let us be ignorant. Keep reading.
You know that ye should, were the Gentiles carried away unto the dumb idols.
Dumb idols. Everybody in here that done something dumb and stupid in their life. Amen. But what we do as Christians, we talk about the next person. Girl, let me tell you, that was stupid. She went down there with that man and she ain't had no business over there with him. And do do do. What we supposed to be doing as Christians? We supposed to be lifting one another up. And keep reading, because we want to get to the love part.
Even as ye were led, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calling Jesus accused, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord but by the Holy Ghost.
But by the Holy Spirit. Do everybody in this room believe that Jesus is Lord?
Amen.
Do everybody here believe that Christ laid down his life for every last one of our souls? We believe that. Keep reading. Because we all on the same accord right now. Keep reading.
Now, there are diversities of gifts.
Diversities, meaning there are different gifts. Yours is to sing, mine is to teach, the bishop's job is to preach. I'm not a preacher, I'm a teacher. I can take you to the word and I can guide you to the paths of God. But I'm not going to be up here hawking and coughing and spitting nothing but stuff. I'm just going to break the word down so that you can understand it. Keep reading, because see, God is speaking to y'all right now. This ain't me. I'm just guiding you. Keep reading.
But the same Spirit.
The same Spirit.
And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord.
The same God that blessed you with a gift, blessed me with a gift. Amen. I don't got no business with my mouth against you. You don't have your business with your mouth against me. Right. Because we supposed to be working together. Amen. I need you. We know what the songwriter said. I need you. You need me. We all a part of God's body. We are the body of Christ. So I can't be jealous, as the scripture's going to show you. I can't be jealous of the eye. Look at the foot. The foot can't say, I don't need the eyeball. Or the ear say, I don't need the right hand. Keep reading. Come on, keep reading.
And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same. God which worketh all in one. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit.
With all. We all have a gift inside us. Everybody in here, down to this little baby right here, have a gift. And it's all needed in the house of God, in the spirit realm of God. Because the Bible says in Ephesians, I believe that's 4:16 and 4:17, somebody want to go and confirm it, because I don't have my notes, I got to come from the heart. And it says that every tongue, it tells us in summary, every tongue must knit together and edify in the body of Christ and love. I need you to read some little bit more. Come on, keep on reading that. I need to close that out so we can go to the next phase. I'm just laying a foundation because I have.
For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gift, the gifts of healing by the Spirit, by the same Spirit, to another the working of
miracles. This is why I mean God said miracles. The miracles. We look at the fivefold ministry and we look at the pastor, the prophets, the teachers, but we have not calculated the miracles that come out of the working of the edifying the body of Christ in love. That love part is so significant. Because how do we get to know God? How do we trust God on our own? How do we really hold on to God's unchanging hand and just trust Him for the worst case scenario to manifest? How do we do this? I'm going to show y'all, because a lot of people struggle with receiving or understanding the word. Somebody go, Ray, I want you to go to Jeremiah, Holy Spirit. Jeremiah chapter 12.
Yes, Lord, I heard you.
I said, go to Jeremiah chapter 12. He want me to show y'all how y'all can build on a relationship with Him. See, a lot of us, we are afraid to approach God because we're scared. Because, you know, everything about God is holy and sacred. And so we supposed to come to Him humbly when we come to Him. But we don't know how to boldly go before the throne of God and speak what's really, really in our heart. Mm. Are you in chapter 12 of Jeremiah?
Yeah.
So God said, He said, show the people. Show the people how to connect with me. Right now, read the first verse.
You're always righteous, Lord.
Give him a mic, because I need y'all to hear this. I need y'all to hear this. Speak loud. We don't know how to relate to God because we're afraid to punch Him.
All right, it says, You're always righteous, Lord, when I bring case before you. Yet I will speak with you about your justice. Why does the way of the wicked prosper?
Stop right there. Who's talking? Who's talking in that first verse?
Jeremiah.
Do anybody agree with him?
Yeah. Yeah.
Who started this conversation? Who's talking in verse 1?
Jeremiah.
It's Jeremiah. Okay, what did he say in the second verse? And who is Jeremiah talking to?
He says,
who is he talking to?
He's talking to God.
Come on now. That's where I want you to go. Come on.
He said, you have planted them and they have taken root.
He complaining about the people. He complaining about the people in the street, the people in the church, the people in the house of God. You are you that planted them. They done planted. They done took root against us. They going to keep it. Because God telling y'all what to happen, what's happening.
They grow and bear fruit. You are always on their lips, but far from their heart.
They far from the heart of God. These folk will come, wait, they'll come, and they always got something good to say about the Lord. But their hearts is far from God. They got their mouth against you, their eyeballs rolled up against you, and we don't understand that when we are representing God, we can be the greatest discouragement on the earth, because people come up in the house of God looking for God for real. They come in here because they want to find God for real. They want to be saved for real. They want yokes broken in their life for real. But when they come in and see a bunch of food in this body and mayhem, now they discouraged. We done lost the soul. But, you know, if you and me, the 99, to go after the one, why would you run off the 99? Make it make sense. It does not make any absolute sense. So our conduct and the way we carry ourselves before God is being held accountable. Keep reading. What else did Jeremiah say to God in his distress?
It says, yeah, you know me, Lord.
You know me, God. You know who I am. But I got to go up in here and deal with the people's this and deal with the people's that. You know me. I ain't like them. We always want to be different, because the Bible says every man own eyes, he right. But God examines the heart. We ain't going to never see no wrong in ourselves. I'm going to see you messed up. I'm going to see you messed up. I'm going to tell you what changes you need to make. I'm going to tell you what you ought to do to get your soul life, your life right with God. But I'm all messed up. I'm going to tell y'all later, as I go, how I got messed up in God. Keep reading, Raylon.
It says, you see me and test my thoughts. You drag them off like sheep to be butchered. Set them apart for the day of slaughter. How long will the land lie parched?
Read that one more again, and I want you to read it with some authority so you can be heard. God tried to get his voice heard. We can't hear that mumbling and scrabbling.
It says, you see me and test my thoughts.
You see me, God. You testing my thoughts. Keep going.
You see me and test my thoughts about you. Drag them off like sheep to be butchered.
Jeremiah told God to kill the people.
says, set them apart for the day of slaughter. How long will the land lie parched and the grass in the field be withered?
How long do I go through these calamities? How long do I go through these afflictions? How long, Lord, am I going to keep getting beat down by man, humanity, the church, the members of the church, the people in the neighborhood? How long do I must take it? Because you know me, God, but I can't take it no more. Why don't you just shoot them in the back of the head and get rid of them for me? But God, that I was ragging one day myself.
My God.
Myself. What is he saying? Who's finna start talking next,
Raylan? He said, because those who live in it are wicked. The animals and the birds have perished. Moreover, the people are saying he will not see what happens to us. And then it says, God's answer.
Now, that's what we want to get to. God's answer. And before we get to God's answer, I want to say this. Honestly speaking, I've been through a lot of ministry and a lot of churches. And I seen a lot of wickedness. And I took off running. I wouldn't stand fast because I didn't have to tolerate it. And then I found myself buried at home, looking into God, just me and God, just self. And I denied the assembly of God. I didn't want to. The Bible says, forsake not the assembly of the house of the Lord thy God. But the people discouraged me so much. I don't want to be in the house of God to assemble with his wicked people. I'd rather that they had been dead. But see, when we have a calling on our life and we have a gift, you know, old people told me, you got a calling on our life. I don't want no calling on my life. I was running like Jonah. I didn't want to be called. Amen. I ran, because I didn't understand what God wanted from me. I didn't understand this thing. Even though they anointed me, the elders blessed me, they encouraged me, and they insisted what God was going to do with me. What did God say? After Jeremiah did all this nibbling and whining and all this complaining.
If you have raced with men on foot and they have worn you out,
how if you wore out by what Joe Blow said, you ain't going to make it up here in this pulpit. If they don't wore you out, you weary by them. How you gonna contend with them? What did God say? How you gonna contend with the horsemen? If you can't take this, you ain't got no business in the pulpit. Now my notes are gone, but the Lord gave me this word, no dice. And he said, daughter, what is a no dice? So anybody know what a no dice is?
No.
Yeah, I believe that's 1 Timothy 5:14, might be there. I believe it was 1 Timothy 5:14, something like that. He said, do not be a novice. A novice is an inexperienced person. He said, I would not have you to be a novice. A novice is like, you see a 7-year-old child prodigy. Hear this baby, can sing and play the harp and the piano. Oh, this child is anointed. So we're going to take this 7-year-old anointed child, because this child will move the ministry, and we're going to place him in the pulpit with a microphone. That's a novice. That 7-year-old may be anointed, but he can't deliver the congregation. That 7-year-old is not old enough, experienced enough to bring the people out of their calamity and their affliction. That 7-year-old don't have no experience. But God said, tell the people today, not only do a 7-year-old ain't got no business in the pulpit, and they not equipped, they not spiritually equipped to be there, they not ready to be there. He said some of them are 75 years old and shouldn't be there.
Come on.
Because they have not had enough experience. I know some people got saved at 61.
Come on.
And at 61 and a half, they want to preach something to me, but you ain't been through nothing. You ain't suffered nothing. When you come to me and you done been beat down like David and them, like when you got beat down like David, when you come to me a liar, a thief, an alcoholic, a murderer, a rapist, and then God done delivered you can preach to me, because you done been through something.
Come on,
you done put the crack pipe back.
Come on.
You done stop messing with little kids. You just not robbing banks, and God done delivered you from out of your murky clay. You the preach to me. But the nobody can tell me nothing. Ain't no young inexperienced person that ain't had no experience in this pulpit can tell me, lead me to God and make me believe him. Let me say this. Go to Deuteronomy 28, somebody. I'm going to start talking about myself. The troubles I got caught in. Because see, God wants us to build on a relationship with him. And the only way we're going to build on a relationship with God if we talk to him. If we talk to him. Like Jeremiah talked to God. Jeremiah said, God, why do the wicked prosper? What's going on with them? When they so horrible, they done took root, they planted, they growing up. What's going on with it? How do I get rid of this mess? What is it, God? Help me with this. Help me with this. Go to Deuteronomy 28. Somebody, anybody. Come on, sis. Start reading. This is what God wants us to do.
And it shall come to pass, if thou shalt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments, which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth.
That's verse 1. That's verse 1. If you are in Deuteronomy 28, it has two statements, that chapter. The first half of Deuteronomy 28 talks about the blessings of the obedient. Am I correct? Who's in that? What did it talk about? The blessings of who?
The obedient.
The obedient. And he said, what did he say in verse 1? If you will hearken
diligently unto his voice.
Unto his voice.
And observe and do all his commandments.
All of his commandments. He didn't say some of them. Mm. He said all of his commandments. Keep reading.
Which I command thee this day.
This day. Come on.
Not tomorrow, this day.
That's right.
That the Lord thy God will set thee on high above
all nations of the earth. Now, go up there to verse 4, because I want to show y'all something. Go to verse 4 when he said, and you'll be blessed going in and coming out. And go there, read that part for me.
Blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, yes, and the fruit of thy ground, and the fruit of thy cattle, the increase of thy kind, and the flocks of thy sheep.
Stop right there. So, if the scripture said, if God said to Moses, he said, if you will hearken diligently unto my voice, I'm going, all these blessings will befall you. All these blessings, got all this good stuff on you. Let me tell y'all something. How I got in trouble with God. Half reading his word, playing with it. I got caught up because I was taught to study the word of God, and I had like a little bit too much in me. And a lot of things was declared upon my life in terms of my relationship. And when I got to Deuteronomy 28, it became one of my most favorite scriptures or books, because it taught me something. Deuteronomy taught me life in a way that blew my mind. When I read that passage, Deuteronomy 28, and I got to that part where you're talking about the blessings of you be blessed going in the city, blessed coming out of the city. The fruit of your womb will be blessed, the fruit of your land, your cattle, everything about you will be blessed.
Yes. My
God. I stopped reading. I was satisfied. And I think you met me around that time. I was so content. It was like 10 years ago. I was like, sure, I'm blessed. Because I'm a child of God. And you know, I ran from Atlanta to the Pacific with Old Glory Ministry. Just flossing. I was flossing, y'all. Out there kidding me. With the big wigs. We preaching in Hollywood. We up there with, Angela Bassett's husband name? Cody Vance. Courtney Vance, Queen Latifah, Gary Coleman, Dad, the next year we got there. Because they came and I beat my motherboard right now. Y'all was there, y'all know. And so, I would hang out with my big mama, and I'd be up there when they had them big events with all these big wigs with my Armani suits on. I'm shy. I got on the Omega Sheen, $500 perfumes, $1,000 wig. I step up in the paper, I'm flying. What? I'm looking good. Then I'm all up in the pulpit. I'm shining. But see, I was up there, I was looking good for me. Unbeknownst to me, I was playing with God. It's like them Israelites did back in Numbers chapter 11. The Bible said they rose up early to play with God. So I'm up there looking good. See, did nobody see God? They saw me. I was up there stepping. Boy, you see these $5 shoes I got on. I want you to see me stepping. I wasn't up there trying to illustrate God. I was up there playing with God. See, I was satisfied when I heard about the blessings of the obedient. But see, if I weak, simple-minded man, I didn't realize that I wasn't being obedient. And see, I didn't read further. Then things started happening. Calamity came. All type of stuff started happening. My baby stopped dying. I had to bury my children. Some of y'all have followed me on Facebook. Y'all seen my journey. Now, I'm playing with God. I'm jumping around church to church. Here comes some man telling me, you look good. God said you was my husband. Now, that wrong fire spurred up. So I run to the altar and married his demon because I was cute to him. Ooh, I was cute to him. This man gonna be my cousin. He got my back. The Lord sent me a husband. The Lord said, I told you that was not your husband. See, I used the wrong man and let the wrong man drag me from under the God, under the word of God. See, I was in the right path, but I got caught up in my flesh. I let my flesh rob me. So I done married the man. He gonna please and turn out. He was a lying, crackhead, thieving, murderous dog. And I said I do to that demon. Then I lost my babies. And I said, God, what's going on? I'm losing my children one by one. Not only did I lose my babies, I lost my grandbabies. Because what I didn't do was hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God and obey his commandments so that he could raise me on high above all nations on earth. I prayed with God. And somebody go to Deuteronomy 28:32. I'm going to tell you what happened. Verse 32 in Deuteronomy 20. I just want to show y'all something. I want y'all to see something.
Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thy eyes shall look and fed with longing for them all the day long.
And there will be no might in thy hand. Go to 15 verse. Go to 14 verse. Read what the word says. Just tell me what it says. Get that right under. He said, these will be the curses of the disobedient. These were the curses. And so when the Lord said, let me tell y'all something. I couldn't understand all this. I said, Lord, I buried my children, and now the popos have got the handcuff on me. They throw me in jail, say, I beat, raped, and strangled kids and robbed the children. And oh, you know you're my witness. They say I did all these things, and they sent me to 43 years. At 53 years old. I said, Lord, I didn't beat the kids, I didn't rape them, and I didn't strangle the kids, but the people gave me 43 years, so I'm being lied on and thrown in prison. And so, while I was locked up, I asked God when they were walking me down the green mountain. I said, because see, I wasn't thinking about God when I was out there in the world. But when that man put them handcuffs on me and started walking me down through the other side of the, on the other side of the world, I said, Lord, me and you finna do 43 years. Lord, we finna do some time. God wasn't in my life before I got sick. Lord, they finna give me and you 43 years. Lord, we finna, Lord, you gonna let me do 43 years. I'm 43 years. I can't do 43 years, God. He said, you you're going to praise your way out of this situation. And the Lord said, go back. This is why I was locked up. He said, go back and finish reading Deuteronomy. He said, see, you got happy with the blessings of the obedient, and you wasn't obedient. Now I'm going to show you why you messed up. Because the cousin of the disobedient, he said, your sons and your daughters will be given to other people.
Come on.
He said, your eyes will look upon them, longing for them. And he said, there will be no might in thy hand. Y'all don't understand. Y'all don't understand. Some of us, and come, you can feel me, because you just came from a man being sick, from murdering your son. You know what it's like as a mother to bury your babies. Imagine. Somebody take on all of your babies. Imagine that. And then your grandbabies. So I can say, well, my mama did this to me. The judge did this. The courts did this to me. Everybody came running after me. And people did these wrong things to put me in this position. But God said, go and read Deuteronomy 22 and 32. He said, and if you do not hearken unto my voice and obey my commandments, these will be the curses. And that's what happened to me. Just like it happened to me, the same curses will fall upon you. But let me tell you, I told God, I said, God, I'm sorry. God, I'm sorry. I repent. And I promise God. See, I've been lying to him. I've been lying to God for every bit of all my life. And so God said, you won't marry somebody. You won't get this thing right. So I said, God. I said, God, if you give me my babies back. He said, he showed me too. He said, I'm going to give you the firstborn generation. And I'm going to give you your last. So Lexus, she's the firstborn of this generation. And the one that y'all know I've been snipping and whining for. God, what happened to the 15-year-old? See, I promised God. I said, if you give him back to me, if you give me my babies back, I'm going to bring them to you. And I'm going to show them how to find you.
Come on.
In spirit and truth. And I'm going to keep
you
my word to God.
This thing.
And next thing, I want to say this.
You better preach this thing.
I want to say this to you. I was hurt. And I blamed everybody in the family.
Come
my
on,
mama,
man.
My brother, my sister, my cousin. But God said, you got to take some accountability.
Come on.
What you did. You didn't hearken to my voice. You didn't obey my commandment.
Come on,
so I took your baby. It's not their fault. Come here, baby. It was your grandmama's fault. It was the thing your grandmama did to get you in this position. But I'm back. And God is back.
Hallelujah.
And he got you.
He got you.
I want you to know I'm sorry. I'm sorry that you suffered. You suffered like you did. Because of my foolishness.
Hallelujah.
But I ask God to forgive me. I ask God to make a way.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I told him I was sorry. So when I woke up this morning, when I woke up this morning, God said, I'm going to put this word in your spirit. And I want you to show the people how to find me. And the phone rang. And I said, Lord Jesus, it was my mother. I ain't spoke to her years. She said, I'm putting, here's y'all's surprise. Noodle will be that Saturday. She put my grandbaby on the plane. She'll be here Saturday. He said, I'm going to give you the first one. And I'm going to give you the last one.
Okay.
And you're going to train them up. You're going to teach them how to trust me, how to love me, how to honor me, and how to live for me. So that they cannot fall that way, son. Suffered enough. If y'all tired of suffering, trying to do things y'all way, God said, if you tired, he said he wants you to trust. But he gave me this word. Consume you. Lie and make that an apple. Send it up straight fires to God. because he has anointed this altar with his blood. And he said, get y'all houses right. Get them in order. He went to Psalms 82 before that.
How long will ye judge the unjustly and accept the person of the wicked? Defend the poor and fatherless. Do justice to the afflicted and needy.
God said, I have. He said, I have come to deliver the poor and the needy, and I will rid them from the hands of the wicked. This is the word that the Father God came unto me, bearing unto me. He said, I'm with you from the hands of a wicked. I ain't the only one out here. Kids messed up. They lost their babies. Some of your babies ain't in the grave, but they walking dead. They spiritually dead. God said, y'all got to come alive in here. You got to get in this word inside. Y'all got to go back to Numbers. Go to Numbers chapter 12, and you will see where God got in the face of Moses and told him, Miriam and Aaron, don't call my servant no prophet. I would have came to him in a dream. He said, but this is my servant whom I please. I speak to him face to face. God wants y'all in his face. And the only way you're going to find him, if you put your face in these scriptures, you can't come up in here where we're performed. You need the book. You need to see what the book says. Go Google, I set you up with a lie. And Mr. Stewart, get the book. Get the book. God said, get to know me for yourself. Get to know me for yourself. Not what man got to make a man to tell you a piece of what he wants you to know. God said, find him. He said, find him. And he said, find him through love and kindness. He said, love and kindness have outdrawn thee. Love and kindness. And we got to have the same love and kindness for one another. See, I don't know your story. I don't know what you've been through, Jessica. I dare put my mouth against you. I don't know what you suffered. I don't know nothing about your losses. I don't know what you struggled through. I don't know what you believe God for. But whatever it is, I'm here to subjoin with you. I want to knit together. I want to take your hand. And I want to look eye to eye and walk with you while Jesus is walking with me. Because we have a responsibility for each other. I didn't come to church to put you down. I came here to lift you up. But I come to lift you up with his word. Not coming up in here unclean. He said, whatever we do in his house, it must be in decency and in order. We can't come up here playing with God. We can't come up here busting stars with being said, this is my husband, and he's not. We can't play with God. He'll burn you up on his altar. You see my suffering, sister. You see me. I live with my sister. I live with her, and she my witness. I lay in that bed a many days crying out for my babies. I lived in my world. You will find me at that American Legion with me alone. But I was at the Domino table. I wasn't there with Tom Jones and Larry Blake. I wasn't with them people. I enjoyed playing domino. When the game was over, I was at home in the world crying out, saying, I don't know why they doing this to me. Why they did this to me. Why they did that to me. Because I have never held myself accountable for who I was against myself. I learned that I was my biggest enemy. I beat myself up. I got tired of whooping on myself, my own behalf. That's why God said today, I want you to stand before the people and tell them. I asked him, God, what do I look like? He said, you look like the donkey that killed me. But I'm on this back, the prophet on this back. Oh, so I'm a dumbass. I'm a dumbass. And stand before y'all, because this is God speaking today. Because I'm just a dumbass. I'm carrying the prophet on my back.
You're good.
Carrying the prophet on my back.
You're good.
Oh, shut up. I'm carrying the prophets on my back. Y'all hate him. I'm carrying the saints on my back. I'm carrying the leaders on my back. I'm carrying the teachers on my back. The pastors on my back. Because they don't believe God for real. They plan. Operating out of their own agendas. And ain't no holy power. God say, I leave you with power and authority. see nobody have a man authority that cast out man demon.
Right.
I wish one would. I look for
one. I love some man demon. I'm coming to snap him right out your window because I'm scared. And that's the thing.
The people think I'm scared, but I ain't. I'm bold.
That's right.
I'm going to tell you, but God said, you ain't got to like me. The Lord gave me the gift to teach.
He didn't give me a gift to feel bad because I'm being disliked. That was not in the plan. It was not part of the agenda to be worried about what somebody got to say. He said, go in there and deliver my word. Lay the foundation and get out of there.
Come on.
That's what we got to do.
Come.
But God said, we're at the elders.
Come on.
Of the church.
Come on.
Because I know when I was coming up, it was grandmama was up in there. Them women was around that altar in that white. And when we brought our cute hand up there, flouncing our shape, they snatched it out and back off from our feet and slung it down on us and pulled all on our head. And did not pray the women together.
Yes, they did.
Where they at? God said, where are my elders? Where are the elders and the deacons of the church?
Where are they?
He's asking y'all questions. He said, where you at? He said, I said, God, I think they're too busy beating themselves up. That's why they can't find you. Because they're beating up themselves and blaming the other people.
Blaming other people. Come on. That's the big thing.
Help me, God.
Blaming the other people.
Help me, God. The devil stole my notes.
And they accepted
it. But God spoke to y'all
through
the scriptures. I'm going to tell you, God set you up.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all got to be careful what you're asking for.
Mm-hmm.
Or what he tell you to do. Because he's going to test you.
Mm-hmm.
He won't tempt you. Mm-hmm. But he's going to test you. He's going to have you to, he's going to test your integrity. He's going to come after your integrity. God will see you down a path that ain't got nothing to do with you, just to test your integrity. Well, did you hold your head up? So I had a blessing for you. The blessing was bigger. But you got caught up with what your brother had going on and didn't maintain your focus on what God had for you. And missed out. Now you got to start the test all over again because you messed up. You messed up. Not the man you was talking about. Not the lady down the street that's talking about you. Not what the bishop said. Not what the deacon said. You messed up.
You did.
Now you got to start this thing all over again.
Yes.
One thing I don't want to do is go back and rebury some kids.
Come on.
And be fighting the court system trying to find some grandbaby.
Come on.
Because of what I did. I can't blame the mama. I can't blame my daddy. I can't blame my sons and daughters for not listening to me because I wasn't listening to God myself. I got to take it like a woman. The way he gave it to me is the way I got to take it. I wanted the devil say, you should hate your mother to the day she died. I said, no, you ain't lying, no truth in it. I love my mother because one day she might have did some things I didn't like. But the one thing my mother did that I will never take from her was turn me on a pillow in church. I would lay there on the surface me, laying there. Watching them praise and walk one through the church. So my mama planted me just like a seed in the house of God.
Come on.
And I grew. Now here's the harvest.
Come on.
I'm no harvest today because I found God and got to know it for myself. But it took me to go through the blessing, the curses of the disobedient to come into an understanding with God.
Ooh.
So that's why I don't care what the people say. I don't care what the people think. Water. He made the dead water sweet. Yes, he did. He brought me out of the land of the land and of Egypt and brought me into the land of milk and honey. And he kept me. He gave me a pillar of light. I've been living by day in a pillar of cloud by night. God was with me when my mama wasn't, when my daddy wasn't. Jesus said in Matthew 13, if you love your mother and your father more than me, you ain't worthy. If you love your sons and daughters more than me, you're not worthy of me. Are you willing to turn your back on your loved ones and give all your all to God? Are you willing to surrender and say, forgive them and do like Acts 2 and 40 say? Save yourself from this untoward generation. Will you do that? No, because we're going to live our life as the worrying kind. Not the worrying kind. We're supposed to be warring in God, not worrying in God. So when they come at you,
When they come at me with all the bad news and the low vibration, I begin to praise God. In spite of what the enemy done. In spite of. Because when I seen them people said 43 years, I lay on my bunk. And the white girl said, what you do? I said, I didn't do nothing. I can tell you what they said I did. And I told her my story. She said, well, if your story is true, if it's true. I said, well, you believe it's true. I said, I'm going to get out of this thing. And she said, it's true. I know a man. His name is the same. And so she took my case, ran over and told me. And I never heard, not the smart girl, not a word, I never heard of poikinization. She said, we're going to send off for your poikinization transcripts. And when they come back, and everything you said is recorded in that court, if it's there, all that you said, that man will walk you out of here. My organization transcripts came back, and two women came from different directions from the house. Said, Humphrey, Mr. Sam wants you. And I go to the room, they had a big old round table, and Mr. Sam had the files there. He said, sit down. This is all I lack. I'm going to walk you out the gate. When I was looking at 43 years, I was out there 17 months. God sent somebody that followed a lie. And they walked me out of that prison house. Because I believe God. I believe God. And the only way for my promise to God to have been fulfilled, I told him, if you let me have the key back, I will do what you called me to do. So they back. So I can't be locked up and raising no
children. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Glory. Glory.
Thank you, Lord.
And I just wanted to recap what the man of God said last week about us being the body of Christ. I need you. I mean, the days I came to you, laying my burdens, I had nobody to vent to. It was just me and God. But somebody heard me. And this is the one woman he put in my face. She said, I believe you. It meant so much to me that somebody believed my story. Because what nobody did, I gave all right. Did nobody want to listen to what she had to say about TBJ and PJ? For years, these women were crying out unheard. But I want y'all to know today, you can cry to everybody you want to. It will always be an endless result, a dead end result. But if you open your mouth and you cry to God, it's always a way out. It's always a way out.
Yes.
If you operate out of your faith.
Yes.
If you let God use you. If you just lay down all your burden, cast them all on him because he cares for you. God will deliver you out. And like he said, he will rid the enemy. He will rid the enemy of his hands that's on you. Let God use us. Let God use us. Let's stay out of other people's business affairs. Whether they're doing right or wrong in your eyes, if we're not judges. Because if we're going to be Bible thumpers, Matthew 7:1 say, judge that you be not judged. And verse 2 say, the same message that you judge shall be measured unto you. So that night you got in my back. Somebody got two of yours. And three in theirs. And four on. It's a trickle down domino.
Yeah.
Y'all pray my strength in the Lord.
Amen.
Pastor Ernest, when you come and pray us out, man of God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
How about
thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, hallelujah. Put that song back on for me if you can. Jesus is love.
I already told you.
Thank you. Pastor Ernest, thank you so much. Ooh, hallelujah.
Ooh, oh, Lord. Jesus. Yes. Thank you.
Oh, my God.
Next
time.
Whoa, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Come on, saints, come on, saints, come on, saints.
Thank you, Lord God.
Give God praise right now for the word that went forth. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God, for your servant, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God, for giving us a testimony, Lord God, of your word and your grace, Lord God. Father, we ask that you to return unto her 100-fold, Lord God. Oh, God,
you
finish her, Lord God. In the name of Jesus,
thank you,
Lord God, for the counterfeit to the soul of her feet, Lord God. Everything that she gave up, Lord God, move upon her. Move upon her in our household, Lord God. Move by favor, Lord God. Move by favor, Lord God. Favor, 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 in the name. bread in our household, God. Fill it with your spirit. Fill it right now in the name of Jesus. Let it not be empty. No emptiness. I declare and I decree. Bless God. In the name of Jesus. Overflow. Overflow. In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Let our heart be full. Lift your voice to God. Lift your voices unto God. Hallelujah. For He is worthy. He is worthy to be worshipped. He is worthy to be worshipped. He is worthy of your praise. He is worthy of your hallelujah. He is worthy. Hallelujah. God, we worship you right now. We take time out, Lord, to give you praise. To give you worship, Lord. We honor you in this moment. We honor you in this moment. God, you didn't have to do this, do it. Save our lives. So beautiful. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Sorry.